Hello, everybody. I wanted to welcome you to our presentation today, in which I will be speaking about the modern digital world and how the equipment that Park Systems manufactures integrates and enables the development of devices, which in turn enable this digital world to be around us. My name is Doru Florescu. I am with Park Systems. And I would like to go over the presentation outline that you will be seeing next. So the topics are how the innovation is driving the current technology trends and how the digital world is become available now in our hands. That is being done through smart mobile devices, and we used to call the cell phone, and we'll look at the architecture of the cell phone. And then the intrinsic components of the cell phones, which are the transistors, and how these transistors are being fabricated. My last part of the presentation, I'll be speaking about our equipment, which is atomic force microscopy, and we'll wrap the presentation up, leave it open for any questions that will be coming afterwards. With that, so looking at these modern technology trends, as shown in this graphic on the right-hand side, there are many, many disruptive technologies such as mobile internet, automation, Internet of Things, cloud, autonomous vehicles that are being enabled by very, very strong and powerful advances in the design and the manufacturing of integrated circuits. Some of the characteristics that these circuits require and these technologies require are a large and a fast data transfer, large storage, computing speeds, machine learning. So, you pick up algorithms, automation, and many more. And these are critical performance areas for which the device makers for integrated circuits are focusing their efforts. So, this digital world is now in our hands. Many, many years ago, we used to have computers that would be standalone, and then we connected to the internet. Everything was done from very, very large devices that were placed in our offices at home. But now we have these very powerful devices, which are portable and enable us to conduct a lot of work and a lot of data and information exchange from literally our hands. So these devices enable us to do, research, information access, communication, phone calls, texts, capture memories, pictures and videos. You can shop, you can bank, you can, check your airline, you can print, you don't even have to print your boarding pass anymore. So these devices are now available in small sizes. And if we look in more detail at a smart mobile device, people still like to call it cell phone. It's a very, very intricate and complicated device. We really don't use the cell phone just for phone calls much more, although we speak at it a lot. But looking at its capabilities, you have a cellular unit and you have a mobile computing unit. So it's a microcomputer. It's like a mini tablet. And some statistics showing the traction that these devices are getting in the modern world. So about 3 billion users worldwide for mobile devices. And for a single user, in average, the person clicks or taps or does something on his or her device about 2,600 times a day, 2,600 times a day we do that. And again, in average, people spend more than 170 minutes a day using this device. So that tells you the complexity and the expanded use of these devices. And looking at their architecture, they're very, very complex and very, very advanced pieces of equipment. So you have about 20 to 24 integrated circuit chips per device. And if you add up the number of transistors in each device, you come up with a staggering number, more than 300 billion transistors per device. And we have here a graphic showing this phone, the Galaxy Note 7, a cross section through it. and you can see a lot of devices and a lot of, you know, sensors and controllers, and you have multiple vendors that, you know, participate in this. You have Qualcomm, you have all sorts of technology that comes together to enable this device to function fast, reliable, and so forth. So looking one step further into transistors. So transistors are the core of these integrated circuits. As I mentioned before, you have billions of transistors for an IC. So what are the sizes and what are the steps to manufacture these transistors? Well, it turns out current modern transistors are actually in the 5 to 10 nanometer range. So their active areas are about 5 to 10 nanometer range. It takes over 1,000 manufacturing steps to build these transistors. And it takes about 13 to 15 weeks. So this graphic on the lower left side indicates that it starts with an ingot that comes with a pure crystalline, you know, silicon wafer that gets through all these processing steps that include polishing, include film deposition, include lithography, include implantation. And then, you know, you create these transistors on a wafer. The wafer size is usually about 300 millimeter in diameter. And then at the end, they get diced and they get packaged, and you have hundreds and thousands of transistors per wafer. Now, going back to the size, the manufacturing size. So when we say 5 to 10 nanometers, what does that mean? So let's look at, you know, nature. The human DNA, as indicated in this graphic, is about 2 nanometers in diameter. A protein cell, it's about 5 nanometer in diameter. An antibody, what we like to have, you know, when we catch a cold, is about 12 nanometers. And the virus of, you know, influenza virus is about 60 nanometers. So 5 to 10 nanometers for a transistor which gets manufactured is a very small and a very extremely challenging dimension to actually build such devices. It's about 5 to 6 times smaller than an influenza virus. So just keep that in mind, you know, and you know, share that information. It's very, very small. So at Park Systems, we have a large number of atomic force microscopes. We look at research markets. We look at fully automated markets, such that, you know, shown in this graphic, where we have AFMs, which are in a fab. That's where the transistors are being fabricated. So our technology is non-destructive. We don't touch the samples. It actually renders the physical details in three dimensions. So it's a direct measurement. And, you know, we have a lot of applications, as I mentioned, in electronics life, but also life sciences and other areas in which people need to look at small sizes. So we have a scanner, which is decoupled XY from the Z. I'm having three examples here of a small tool. This is a small AFM, a tabletop. This is a larger AFM. And then this is a fully automated AFM that resides in one of these fabrication spaces. And some of the examples, the scans that we have are at the same range. So we can see E. coli, which is a 20 micrometer scan. We can see many, many cells. We have atomic steps at a 1 micron scan. We have a litho structure. Somebody, you know, decided to make a few circles, concentric circles. So this is a 7.5 micron scan. Trenches, these are very similar to the transistors I just mentioned. These are the integral part of the transistor development. So this is a very small scan. It's a 0.5 micron scan, so 500 nanometers. We can look at DNA, just as I indicated, a 1.5 micron scan. IC, and here we have a failure. We have a defect in the IC. And then nanotubes, 2 micron scans. So this technology, being non-destructive, being very accurate, and doing direct measurements on these features is very, very useful and critical to the development of nanoscale devices. So I would like to wrap up my short presentation by summarizing that device innovation, it is, you know, actively driving modern technology. And a lot of it is based on the fact that, you know, the size of the devices is continuously decreasing. So just as the cell phones are much larger, you know, 10 years ago, now we're getting to have them smaller and faster and more powerful. That's due to the fact that device scaling took place. These portable small devices are daily tools for everybody in our contemporary lifestyle. As I mentioned, almost 3 billion people have them. They spend over 170 minutes a day and 2,600 taps and clicks. So, you know, building transistors which are comparable in size with the human DNA and integrating this into a device is quite remarkable. And the latest AFM technology platform, which we present here at Park Systems, is one of the key enablers to designing and manufacturing these devices. We do have a lot of application in semiconductors, in memory spaces, so what I call electronics, life sciences, and many other fields for which such small nanoscale features are to be measured and controlled. With that, I would like to thank everybody for tuning in today. It is my pleasure to give this very short introduction to the Park System technology, and I'll be happy to follow up with any questions that anybody has directly or offline.